presents Hollywood. Lever Brothers Company, the makers of Lux Toilet Soap, brings you the Lux Radio Theatre, starring Dana Andrews and Pat Crowley in War of the Worlds. Ladies and gentlemen, your producer, Mr. Irving Cummings.
Greetings from Hollywood, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight we are going to take a look into the possible frightening future, as though the present weren't bad enough, and see what might happen if our Earth were invaded by another planet. It's George Pal's production for Paramount, War of the Worlds, and our stars are Dana Andrews and Pat Crowley. They will join me later for a preview of George Pal's latest production for Paramount, Conquest of Space. Meanwhile, here's our good friend, Ken Carpenter.
It would be hard to find a man who works as many hours a day as you women do. For instance, you spend 5.5 hours every week just doing dishes, and that's only for a family of four. But Lux Liquid Detergent gives you back some of that time. Lux Liquid is made especially to help you do dishes fast and easy. It floats grease right off. Plates, glasses, utensils, even pots and pans come clean really fast. Just a teaspoonful does a dishpan full. One can outlasts several boxes of the leading laundry powder. Your hands stay nice, too. Lux Liquid is almost as mild as Lux Toilet Soap. The next best thing to a dishwashing machine. That's Lux Liquid. Lever Brothers unconditionally guarantees Lux Liquid is just as wonderful as we say. And the millions of women who've used it have found that Lux Liquid is as good for dishes as Lux Flakes Care is for nylons. Buy it when you market. Lux Liquid in the can with the dripless spout.
Now Act One of War of the Worlds, starring Dana Andrews as Clayton and Pat Crowley as Sylvia.
No one would have believed in the middle of the 20th century that human affairs were being watched keenly and closely by intelligences greater than man's. Yet across the gulf of space on the planet Mars, intellects vast and cool and unsympathetic regarded our Earth with envious eyes, slowly and surely drawing their plans against us. Mars is more than 140 million miles from the sun, and for centuries it has been in the last stages of exhaustion. The inhabitants of this dying planet looked across space with instruments and intelligences of which we have scarcely dreamed, searching for another world to which they could migrate. Their nearest world was giant Jupiter, where the atmospheric pressure is thousands of pounds to the square inch. They could not go there, nor to Saturn, nor to Pluto, planets encased in eternal ice. They could not go to Neptune or Uranus, twin worlds in eternal night, and surrounded by unbreathable atmospheres of methane gas and ammonia vapor. They could not go to Mercury. Its temperature is that of molten lead. Of all the worlds that the intelligences on Mars could see and study, only our own warm Earth was green with vegetation, bright with water, and possessed a cloudy atmosphere eloquent of fertility. It did not occur to mankind that a swift fate may be hanging over us, that it would come at the time of our nearest approach to the orbit of Mars, that it would begin in or over the mountains northeast of Los Angeles, California, on a pleasant summer evening.
Rodeo, this is Pine Summit Lookout. I got a smoke.
Okay, what's your reading?
Azimuth, 160 degrees, 30 minutes. Right where that meteorite just hit. Did you see it?
Not me, but a couple of the guys did. Must have been a pretty big fire.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.